Well, hey, everybody, and happy Friday. And I hope that whenever it is that you watch this video, all is well with you and that you are having a great day. I want to say what a joy it is to me to have this time with you in the Word of God. There is nothing I'd rather be doing and nobody I'd rather be with than all of you as we study together. I hope that you will remind your Facebook friends that we are doing this, that you will invite them, that you will remind them to find the videos on either of my pages, Cheryl Ward or our Heart to Heart with Friends page, and so that they will become a part of this too. The more the merrier, and there's just no greater joy than spending time with friends in the Word. So, a few days ago, we began to look at life at its best, and I shared with you that there were 12 things that I had come up with that have helped me live the abundant life for so many years. Jesus told his disciples in John 10:10, he said, "The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly." Jesus was not talking about a life without problems, hardships, hard times. He was not promising to exempt us from troubles, but he was promising that we could live life on a higher plane as we live life in connection with him, in relationship with him. And I have found that to be so true. I have had my share of hard times, but you know what? In them, he has always been there to help me get through them. And in the good times I've had, the mountaintop experiences of life, he's just made them better. So that's the abundant life. That's the life at its best that we want to experience as we journey along through life. We talked about a relationship with him being first because that's where it all begins. For those of us who have a relationship with him, we already know what the abundant life is. We've already tasted of it and we've gotten used to it. We talked about growing in our relationship with Jesus and how it's not an option for the child of God, that we are to constantly be growing in that relationship, growing in our faith, and becoming more and more like him and the person he wants us to be so that we can make a difference in this world out there on the tracks where he's planted us. We talked about two things, tools maybe that help us in that growth process, the Word of God and prayer, and how closely those are linked together. We talked yesterday about the Word of God, and we looked at some of the prayer, some of the verses that help us know the importance of the Word of God. Andrew Murray says that this is the secret of faith, that there will be only so much faith in us as there is of the Word of God in our soul. And I do believe that with all of my heart, because the more of the Word we have stored in us, the more we are alive to him and the more we will experience him and be able to make our lives count for him. Well, today we're going to look at prayer, that second tool. And I believe that just as the Word of God is linked to to our faith, that it's also linked directly to the quality of our prayer life. And that so, as much as the Word of God we have stored in us, so will be the quality of our prayer life, because they really go together. So let's dig in and begin to look at, are we plugged in and prayed up in our prayer life? I believe that prayer is one of the most precious possessions we have as a child of God, but one of the most neglected. We talk about praying. We study about praying. But do we really get down to praying? Is prayer really a part, an important part of our lives? Joyce Meyer said many years ago that too often you and I run to the phone when we ought to be running to the throne. Well, I know what she meant, and we all do. And it is a wonderful thing that God gives us each other to journey along in life with, and that when we do come upon problems or we hit snags in life, that we have each other to call, that we feel comfortable sharing our hearts with each other. God gives to each one of us people like that. There might just be one or two, but isn't it great that we always have that person we know we can turn to? But how important it is that before we make that call, we talk to God about it. Whatever it is going on in our life, that we tell Him first. Now, we know that He already knows what it is, but I believe that He wants us to come and tell Him and acknowledge Him and how we need Him. So, Jesus' disciples had been with Him, and they had watched Him pray on many occasions, and they had come to understand something of the connection between the miraculous works He did in public and the praying that He did in private. And they knew Him as the master teacher of the art of praying. And one day when they were together and he had been out praying and they had been there watching Him, one of them came then and asked Him, "Lord, teach us to pray." And He did by giving them the model prayer we know as the Lord's Prayer. Well, this morning I want us to say and to pray, "Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray what it's like, and help us to live and begin to live in such a way that we cannot not pray throughout the day, because it becomes so important to us and such an important habit." There are a lot of verses that talk about prayer. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says that we're to pray without ceasing. And that means that we're just to learn to live in an attitude of prayer, to live in an atmosphere of prayer, so that prayer just becomes a part of everything that we do throughout the day. There are two mentors I've had in as I've journeyed along through life, spiritual mentors that I've never met, but I hope I'll get to see one day in heaven, and I believe I will. Gloria Gaither is one of those mentors. Not only her singing and the songs she's written, but the poems she's written, the journal that she wrote many years ago, and just so many glimpses of her life have helped me and encouraged me in my own life. But she talks about her prayer life, and I love these words and how she describes it, because it is prayer without ceasing. She said, "Most often, my communication with God is so blended into the mental processes of my day that I can't really call it prayer in the formal sense. Instead, prayer to me has been more of an 'it's me and you, Lord,' awareness that has been, that is very portable and requires no special pose. Often prayer in my life has taken the forms of panicked cries for help, ecstatic exclamations of joy, deep, inexpressible feelings of gratitude, and the overwhelming awareness of my need for Him. God walks with me. And when I am least able because of fatigue or stress or the urgent demands placed on me by the people He's brought into my life, when I'm least able, she says, to follow the prescribed fundamentals of prayer or to strike some meditative pose, he scoops me up in his arms or simply sits with me in silent strength until I cannot avoid the awesome recognition that, yes, even now, he is there. Isn't that just, well, it's beautifully written, but it means so much. Helen Steiner Rice was another of my mentors, and she reflects on her prayer life, and she says, I believe there is a spiritual principle involved, one that is alluded to in Isaiah 65:24, which reads, before they call, I will answer, and while they are yet speaking, I will hear. As I have made prayer a regular part of my life, a daily, hourly, moment by moment demonstration of my faith, I have had an open line with my Heavenly Father, and He has been aware of my needs before I've even asked Him. I don't mean that I've been one to walk around with my hands folded in constant prayer and my eyes heavenward. Not that kind of devotion, but the kind that recognizes dependence upon God for everything. I am from the same school as the saint who advised, pray as if everything depended upon God, and work as if everything depended upon you. We learn to pray by praying. And you know, every time I come to Him in prayer, whether kneeling in my study or stretched out before Him in desperation, or in the shower, or riding in the car, or cooking in the kitchen, I thank Him for the faith that He's given me to believe that when I call, He does hear and answer. One of those verses that assures me of that is Jeremiah 33:3, where He says, call upon me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. And I have prayed that prayer to Him and personalized that prayer many times as I've come to Him. Another verse that I love is Hebrews 4:16, where He says that we can come boldly to Him and always find grace to help in time of need. And that we can come boldly. And I think, why would He extend an invitation to me to come boldly to Him? But I know that He looks on me as one of His children, and that He loves me, and He invites me to come so that I can find His grace to help in whatever's going on in my life. James 5:16 is another one of the prayer promises I love, that the effectual prayer of a righteous person availeth much. That's King James. But New Living says that the sincere, heartfelt prayer of a righteous person has great power and wonderful results. And I think about that righteous person. We might say, well, that just excludes us because we are not righteous. But we are in the sight of God. You remember that we traded our sin for His righteousness. He clothed us in His righteousness. And when He looks on us, He sees us as righteous before Him. And He says that when we come and we pray with a sincere heart, that our prayer will have great power and wonderful results. Then Ephesians 3:20, Paul said, now unto Him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask, think, or imagine, according to that power that works in us. I've always liked to say that God answers prayer the Ephesians 3:20 way, far beyond what we can ever believe that He can do. Sometimes it just blows our mind how he answers our prayers. And sometimes we would never have dreamed that he would answer our prayer in the way that he did. Well, there's another verse. Really, it belongs to a passage in Philippians where Paul reminds us to rejoice. And he says, again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation, let your considerateness, let your gentleness be known to all men, for the Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of God that passes all understanding shall guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. How I thank God that many years ago he helped me hide that word in my heart and that it's been there all these years. And what it's really saying is that he invites us and he really tells us, turn your fear, turn your worry, turn your stress, turn your anxiety thoughts into prayer thoughts and let me take those and let me give you my peace. You know, there is nothing in the world that you and I want more today than to know the peace of God. We experience the peace with God when we come to him and he saves us. But we experience that peace of God as we do what he says, as we do what he's just told us, to turn our fear thoughts and worry and anxiety thoughts into prayer thoughts. And after having done all we can, we give it to him, and then he will fill our hearts with his peace. And he says that peace is past understanding. And for you and I who've experienced that peace, we know that it is beyond understanding. In Luke 18, Jesus told his disciples a story encouraging them to not lose heart. Sometimes it's easy for you and me to lose heart when we pray, when the answer doesn't come in the time frame that we thought it would. We really pray most of the time, Lord, if you will do this or that, and will you do it right now? Sometimes he doesn't answer in the way we thought that he would. And we just have a tendency to lose heart. Sometimes we just quit praying. Sometimes we forget about the prayers we pray, but God never forgets. He still remembers them. And Jesus told his disciples that it was important to keep on praying through until the answer comes. And so, you know, I remember the old people talking about praying through until the answer comes. You and I need to learn to do the same, to pray on through until we see God work. If we read the book of Acts, and I like to do that every now and then, to remember the early church and those first believers and how devoted they were to prayer. And I think we find it was a praying church. And they were praying people. And they lived in an atmosphere of prayer. And when they prayed, it worked. Well, I may not pray like those early believers. I may not be as faithful. I may not be as devoted. I may not realize my need as they did. But I know this, that when we pray today, God still answers. When I pray today, God still answers. I could write a book on the answered prayer in my life. And you know, we talk about miracles, like miracles of people being healed, eyes being, blind eyes being opened, deaf ears being opened. But you know what? God has answered so many, he has performed so many miracles in my life in answered prayer. And I think sometimes one of the most wonderful miracles that he does is when I'm going through a hard time and I begin to pray, Lord, help me through this time. I think I'm going to sink this time. And he reminds me, no, I've helped you before and I'm going to help you this time. But I think what a miracle it is when he changes my attitude about what I'm going through. Or either he helps me come to look at what I'm going through his eyes, rather than looking at him through what I'm going through. Because sometimes that thing we're going through looks so big, we think, Lord, there's just no way I can come through this. But God is a God of miracles, and he does hear and answer our prayers. And I believe he just invites us to come and see what he'll do in our lives as we live in an attitude of prayer. I pray that we'll practice that. And I just have enjoyed this so much. I pray, Lord, that you will just help us carry out now what you've put in us, and that we will watch you move and work in our lives, in the lives of those around us, in the lives of our nation in the coming days. In Jesus' name, I love you.